what is the neuroscience of memory? How are memories stored in the brain?
It all starts with perception. When you have an experience, whether it's having a conversation, you know, in a room or walking outside or going up in a hot air balloon, that's a constellation, you know, you're turning the dials on all those things, right? On all the sensory and the inputs, as well as the stored knowledge. And all those things sort of integrate and mix, right, in the brain. So we know the hippocampus is important for memory. And the reason we think it's important is because it's a structure that sort of integrates all that information that I just mentioned, the sensory information, the stored knowledge, the internal, and it creates links outward to other parts of the brain.
What are the factors that go into how deeply consolidated that memory is at the point to which you experience it?
Great question. Number one is attention and arousal. And by arousal, I mean, think of the consciousness of the self as a continuous entity in time. It's recording of experiences from one moment to the next, hours, days, weeks, and so on. You know, that's the kind of consciousness that we study. And that's what we call anterograde amnesia, which is contrary to what we talked about at the beginning, which is retrograde amnesia, where you lose consciousness to your past or inability to access your past. But your experience, your ongoing experience of consciousness is supposedly normal in the sense that remembering and encoding and retaining information over time. I got started studying autobiographical memory and episodic memory because I was so interested in those deficits, the great advantages of memory and the great loss that occurs when you have a memory impairment. Now I'm actually kind of turning to the other side of things. We're actually finding these people have enhanced conceptual abilities. There's an article by one of our index SDAM cases named Nick Watkins. He wrote a great article in Neuropsychologia about, he's a theoretical physicist. So there's someone who traffics in abstract ideas. He thinks, and I agree with him, that his capacities actually are related to his lack of imagery and his lack of memory, because he's really, really good at seeing, if you will, connections conceptually and not getting distracted by irrelevant visual information.
Dr. Brian Levine, welcome to the podcast. I am so excited to talk to you. As a researcher in memory deficits, this is a phenomenon that has fascinated me for a very long time, and I think actually seeded some of my earliest interest in neuroscience itself. I think, like many people, I came across the concept in Oliver Sacks's book, this person who was stuck in the past. And I think it just opened up this whole idea that consciousness is just a very variable thing and it can be radically different for other people, which isn't something that you instinctually think about. So I guess my first question is, what brought you to this fascinating field of memory deficit? How did you get into this?
Yeah, thanks for having me. And for sure, like, I share that kind of entry into it, as you described. In my case, you know, I got into neuropsychology as a clinical neuropsychologist, coming out of a clinical psychology background, and I was always interested in the brain. When I was in intro psych, in university, the prof drew a picture of the brain on the chalkboard, and I was pretty much hooked from there. And went into clinical psych, started studying neuropsychology. Ended up becoming a registered psychologist, where my job was basically diagnosing brain conditions and trying to help, and finding that on both sides, the diagnosis and the treatment, we were pretty limited what we could do. And that kind of led me into research, which connected me up just mainly through a series of kind of I would say good luck, a lot of good luck involved, but also, you know, me taking advantage of those lucky breaks. I ended up in Toronto at a great neuroscience institute called the Rotman Research Institute, which at the time was just beginning sort of its rise as a group, you know, as a leading group in cognitive neuroscience. And I actually went there because I was interested in frontal lobe function, executive functions. So I was studying, and patients with traumatic brain injury was a very common, you know, neurological condition that causes executive impairment. And so I had set up a study and I was testing these people. And at that time, this would have been in the mid-90s, We had, you know, a lot of great people coming through our center to share, you know, share research and give talks. One of those people, his name is Hans Markovitch. He was a German neuroscientist, still is. And he had this theory that the syndrome of retrograde amnesia, which is sort of like what you described in the Oliver Sacks case, right, was related to damage in a specific fiber pathway in the brain that connects the temporal and the frontal lobes called the uncinate fasciculus, which is like Latin for hook, I think. And it's a large fiber pathway that basically connects memory centers with, you know, thinking and reasoning. And but there hadn't been any cases like that. It was just a theory he had based on sort of his own reading of the literature. Anyways, within a matter of weeks, we had a patient come through my study who had retrograde amnesia, and we only caught it because a student had attended Hans's talk, and I was supervising that student. And the student said, well, I wasn't interested in memory at the time. I mean, I wasn't especially interested in memory. It wasn't my thing. But the student was like, hey, can we start asking, maybe someone will come through who has retrograde amnesia. And so I said, well, it's, you know, it's a free country. I mean, if I don't really care, but if you want, you know, go ahead. And so he did. And then he came back and he said, I think we have one. And I, you know, most of these cases, there's usually a mental health or psychological component to it. But in this case, there wasn't. He was a genuine case of isolated retrograde amnesia, which means he had a head injury, he recovered, and then he lost all his memory for the events occurring prior to the head injury. Wow. And it was isolated because he did pretty well on memory testing, what we call antrograde, or, you know, testing from the point of injury forward. His memory was sort of okay. He certainly wasn't amnesic, but it was, he had lost basically his memory for his entire life. And we, you know, through a long series of studies, we actually found that he had the lesion in that exact area that Hans Markovitch had suggested. We were able to show this with imaging, the imaging tools that we had at the time, and publish that case in 1998. And it was, you know, a big deal, like for me personally. And it was, you know, it was a young, you know, neuropsychologist coming up. But I also knew that we had patients like this. This case was fairly dramatic, you know, and remarkable, but we knew that to various degrees, this idea of like your autobiographical memory being affected in specific ways by brain disease, that I knew that as a clinician, that this was something that we dealt with, you know, in various degrees. And we really didn't know anything about it. I mean, we know a lot about memory, but really the area of this, you know, like memories for your life,
yeah,
at the time was just sort of a niche area of cognitive psychology and memory research. I don't think it was taken that seriously. It had sort of a Freudian tinge to it.
Right.
And I got really interested in that. And I think also as someone who just likes, you know, like many people, I like stories. I like reading novels and things. And I'm very interested in those sort of like, how do we tell stories about our lives and the details. And so I just started basically thinking about that, trying to devise new ways to test that. And of course, thinking about the brain side of that was fascinating to me. So that's a very long answer to your question.
It's a great answer.
I got started into that. Yeah.
It's absolutely fascinating to me as well.
You know, it's a lot of this, a lot of science, but thinking about this, a lot of science is really a life. I mean, frankly, is luck, right? You know, it was just timing and luck. And then of course, recognizing that you got something, you know, in this case, it was an interesting case. And it wasn't just me. I mean, there are other people involved, but, you know, it was a combination of luck and then kind of like the pursuit of that. You know, those questions.
Right. So before we dive into the individual nuances of the different fascinating memory deficit disorders, let's lay the groundwork of what is the neuroscience of memory? How are memories stored in the brain?
Right. Yeah. So it all starts with perception, experiences, right? So whatever it is coming through your sensory systems, visual especially, but all the senses, plus perceptions coming from inside of you, feelings, thoughts, sensations from your body, and then, of course, stored knowledge. So you have kind of those three things. You have input from the world, input from yourself, and then input from sort of past memory. So how does memory work? Well, when you have an experience, whether it's having a conversation, you know, in a room or walking outside or going up in a hot air balloon, that's a constellation, you know, you're turning the dials on all those things, right? On all the sensory and the inputs, and as well as the stored knowledge, and all those things sort of integrate and mix, right, in the brain, to create, you know, an experience, which resonates in the brain. So, you know, it's always for people who are interested, it's fun to talk about like what parts of the brain. So of course, many people have heard about the hippocampus, which is deep in the temporal lobes. Patient Henry Mollison had, you know, bilateral damage in the hippocampus and became amnesic as a result. So we know the hippocampus is important for memory. And the reason we think it's important is because it's a structure that sort of integrates all of that information that I just mentioned, the sensory information, the stored knowledge, the internal, and it creates links outward to other parts of the brain that are involved in either processing, you know, whether it's processing whatever was important in that episode. And when you remember an episode, there's some cue, could be a visual cue, it could be a thought, could be a smell, finds its way to the hippocampus, where you can think of that as like a combinatorial code that kind of unlocks that configuration of experiences that bring back a memory. So basically you have a configuration of things that make up an experience. The hippocampus is involved in binding those sensations and thoughts and so on, and stored knowledge. And then, you know, stuff happens when you walk away, you have new experience, stuff happens in the brain. But then when you, and we can talk about that, that's, you know, what some people would refer to as consolidation. But then when you, later on, whether it's the same day or years later, when that memory is reactivated, there'll be some cue that causes that configuration to get, in some form or another, it's not going to be perfect, but in some form or another, to get basically reinstituted in the brain, so you can actually have that experience of reliving the memory.
Right. That was a really nicely put. So is it fair to say that a single memory is basically distributed over your entire brain? So the sensory experience that you incorporated in that moment is stored somewhat in your sensory cortex. The, you know, introceptive experience that you've encoded is in a different place. Your emotions are, I know emotions are complicated, so maybe emotions aren't in one area, yeah, and they're everywhere. But does different brain regions encode a different specific element of that memory, and then the hippocampus is what pulls those threads together and integrates it into some sort of holistic experience. Is that roughly correct?
It is roughly correct, yeah. I mean, when we look at, you know, in brain imaging studies, whether it's fMRI or oscillatory studies, looking at like EEG or, you know, magnetoencephalography, MEG, which we've used, and we ask people to recall events from their lives, we see widely distributed activity in the brain. Certainly, you can detect activity in the hippocampus, although even that will depend somewhat on the nature of the cue. But the whole brain gets involved. You know, it's not isolated; it's distributed. And that's another little angle that I've had, is that, you know, again, just through a good fortune of, you know, being connected with network neuroscientists. You know, we talk about my background as a clinician. I'm not a highly trained, you know, in engineering or coding or computational methods, but I've worked with people who are, and I was very fortunate to get connected to people, you know, in Toronto and elsewhere, that really understand the brain as a network and think about the brain that way as opposed to individual regions, which is sort of the neuropsychological approach of like you're trained, you know, to think. And it's much easier to think in terms of individual regions doing discrete functions. And there is some truth to that, but it's not, there's more to it than that.
Of course. What are the factors that go into how deeply consolidated that memory is at the point to which you experience it?
Great question. Number one is attention and arousal. And by arousal, I mean how engaged are you with whatever that thing is. So, and this is huge. Like, and it seems like a truism, but you know, we remember things that we attend to. But if you think about it, like that's how you know marketing works. You get the emotional system, the noradrenergic system, engaged to turn up your attentional focus and engagement on whatever that thing is. Without that, you know, you're not going to lay down the memories. Like it's even at a cellular level that it enhance that kind of like noradrenergic engagement, arousal, if you will, basically makes the brain receptive to the incoming input. And evolutionarily, the reason is that when you're aroused, something important's happening, potentially important to your survival, to staying alive, to reproduction, to food, things that matter in life, like for a hunter-gatherer or whatever, or any creature. And then you want to remember that something important is happening. Pay attention, right? We could have a whole podcast episode just about that, because you think about our lives now and how our attention is fractionated and divided, you know, by so many things, and there's so much competition for our attention and how that affects, you know, our behavior and our memories and what's important to us. So anyway, I think the question was, what are the things that make memory kind of stick and last? So at the time of the event, you have to remember it. But then of course, there's all sorts of other things that happen. So that the extent to which information resonates with existing knowledge has some interesting factors. So if an event is truly novel and you haven't experienced it before and there's not a ton of stored knowledge, in one sense, you remember it better. So I mentioned a hot air balloon ride. I've actually never been on one of those. But if I was, I'm sure I'd remember it for the rest of my life because it's a completely novel experience. But also, we tend to remember things when we do have a solid stored network of knowledge that can support memory. So let's say you're a basketball fan or a sports fan or whatever, and you know a lot about a particular sport, a particular team, and then you watch a game. That's going to get integrated into that system and really strongly supported. And you remember what happened based on your stored knowledge. Right. Whereas if you're not an expert, that game may be novel, but it's not, you're not going to remember it as much because who cares? Like, I don't follow that sport or whatever. So those two things, I'll stop there, but those are probably the two of the most important things.
It brings up an interesting difference between the different memory systems, because you made a point there that like novelty is important for remembering, mm-hmm. but novelty in semantic information can act against you if that information just has nowhere in the brain to fit into your pre-existing knowledge frameworks. You know, like if you never study neuroscience and then you just suddenly dive into a specific nuclei of the basal ganglia, that's just not going to be retained, right? You don't have anywhere to slot that information. But if you're doing something procedurally, like you're, you know, trying to practice a new swimming technique or something like that, that could be completely novel to you, but for some reason the brain is able to incorporate that very well. So is there a known differences in how we incorporate learned memories in terms of procedural memory versus semantic?
There are different, to some extent, there are different systems, although there's lots of overlap between those systems. And, you know, as you gave those examples, where my mind went was the idea of, like, if you've never studied neuroscience and you're studying the basis of that, that's just gobbledygook, right? You got nothing to latch on to. So the novelty has to be combined with something that you that has some meaning or inherent, you know, you got to have a starting point, right? The procedural, I mean, the procedural motor learning, I mean, these systems for sure can happen, that kind of learning can happen implicitly. Whereas, you know, semantic learning can happen. I mean, they both can be explicit and implicit. And by explicit, I mean, you have conscious control that you're actually trying to learn and remember this thing versus just you learn through exposure and repetition without making a specific, you know, conscious directed effort toward doing that.
Yes. I have a really good implicit versus explicit difference to show you. So you can see it on the screen?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Clive Waring has one of the worst cases of amnesia.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I use this video all the time in my training, teaching.
I assume some as much.
You did, no. Day and night, same thing. No difference in dreams and anything like that. No senses at all. The brain has been totally inactive. No dreams, no thoughts of any kind, whatever.
Clive was a renowned conductor living in London when he was struck down by a virus in 1985. Parts of his brain were completely destroyed, including his memory. However, his ability to play music is unaffected.
Do you feel different when you play music?
I've never heard a note since I've been ill. I don't know what it's like to play music when you're unconscious.
You played us some music about 2 minutes ago.
Not known to me. Totally unknown. I've never heard a note yet.
Clive's case became known to millions when a television documentary was made about him in 1986. Alone and confused in hospital, without his memory, the only person he recognized was his wife, Deborah.
What's been wrong? Can you just tell me what the illness has been? You know, you can't get to this. I'm actually conscious now for the first time. I just want to find out what the bloody hell they've been doing and what's been wrong with me. Because I haven't a fucking clue.
Well, I've
never
seen
anyone at all.
20 years later, Clive only has a 7-second memory before his mind goes blank.
It gets to me every time. Genuinely, it pulls at my heartstrings in all the, you know, extreme ways. Can you explain a little bit about what's going on? I assumed that you knew this case.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We use this all the time in teaching. It's very powerful demonstration, especially, you know, can think about what it's like. It's hard to imagine what it's like for him and the pain, you know, of his wife, you know, having to deal with this. And it's quite significant. So I believe he had a limbic encephalitis, so bilateral medial temporal lobe damage that basically, you know, damaged the hippocampus and made it impossible for him to lay down new memories. So they talked about he has a 7-second memory. So that's basically, you know, your brain holds on to what we often call short-term memory, things that just happen or things that are just in consciousness. You know, you holding up, people don't use remember phone numbers anymore, but we used to say you hold a phone number in mind, that's like short-term memory. So password, I guess, would be the equivalent now. That's all he's got. So he can only hold whatever's in consciousness at any given moment or a connected moment. And as soon as that's interrupted, you know, it's the hippocampus that is involved in the transfer of that information to the cortex so that you can maintain this ongoing sense of consciousness. So what's so interesting about that, about hearing him is he says, you know, it's almost as though he's using neuroscientific terms. He says, I'm not conscious. And he's like, what's going on? I'm not conscious, which is an incredibly sophisticated thing to say, to describe this experience and, you know, kind of captures, you know, what we as experts would the kind of language we would use to say, like, consciousness is the ongoing record of experience over time. I mean, that's, it's not all it is, But to think of the consciousness of the self as a continuous entity in time, it's, recording of experiences from one moment to the next, 1 hour, minutes, day, hours, days, weeks, and so on. And all he has are seconds, that. And so that's the kind of consciousness that we study. And that's what we call anterograde amnesia, which is contrary to what we talked about at the beginning, which is retrograde amnesia, where you lose consciousness for your past or inability to access your past. But your experience, your ongoing experience of consciousness is quote, supposedly normal in the sense that you are remembering and encoding and retaining information over time.
Right. The shortness of that time was quite surprising to me as well. Is 7 seconds the duration? And I know it's roughly variable. I think they say sometimes it's, 15 or sometimes it's 20, but it's kind of no longer than 30 seconds.
Well, it could be.
That's our short-term memory. Storage.
If it's uninterrupted, it could be. So, for example, HM, who's a similar syndrome, you could hold a conversation with him, and I never met him, but I know this is the case, and maintain that information, and he would have an ongoing record of that, even if it were minutes longer, but as soon as there was an interruption, if you left the room and came back, it would be gone. The memory would be gone. So in his case, 7 seconds, I think he had more extensive cortical damage in the limbic encephalitis case. HM was more of a surgical resection, surgical resection in the background of epilepsy. So he may have had more extensive kind of cortical damage that shortened his time window of experience. But I would, and I haven't watched that full documentary in a while, but I would be interested to know, if she sat with him, because you can see it, there are clips that I use in my teaching of that same, from that same documentary where he's having a conversation and he's keeping track. Like he's, you're sitting with him and he's keeping track of the conversation, which suggests that it can go longer than 7 seconds. So that may have been something that they said, under certain circumstances in the documentary, but I think that
it's a catchier heading. Yeah. The effect is communicated.
Yeah.
So what is it that's happening at the point that you break your consciousness or switch focus from one thing to another?
So a better way to answer that might be what's happening in the norm why do we have a continuous consciousness? So I imagine, we don't know what consciousness is like in other creatures, other, lower species. Like, we like to talk about our dog a lot and the fam, stuff that happens. And we're like, is he going to remember, if we leave and we come back, it's like, in fact, in that, documentary, there are clips of him seeing his wife and it's as though she's seeing him for the first time. He's seeing her for the first time. And it's like, as far as he's concerned, it's been, he doesn't even know when he saw her last, but he recognizes her and he greeted her with just tremendous, emotion, even when he just saw her. And that's kind of, I don't want to draw a comparison between him and a dog, but that's what our dog does. When we go out and come back after an hour or two, it's like, oh my God, I can't believe, So anyway, the question is, what is it what is it that allows you to maintain that record of like, I am, even when you sleep, there's stuff happening, my colleague the philosopher Evan Thompson has a whole book about this called Waking, Dreaming, Sleeping, Dying, I think, where if you wake up, someone says, well, how did you sleep? Even if you weren't conscious, quote unquote, conscious the whole time, you have a record, you have information about that experience, right? So, and of course, when we're awake, we generally, it's an ongoing record of experience. So what is it that allows us to do that? And the way I think about it is that, there's a stream of incoming information about your life, your things that you're experiencing, and short-term memory, the cortex of the brain, the sensory systems can support that information online. By online, I mean seconds. But then, if I turn and look at something else, there's going to be something else coming into my cortex or another sound that's going to occupy that, and I can't maintain. So then how does that information that was over there that I'm no longer attending to, there's still a record of it somewhere. And the way I think of it is that that information resonates, it connects with other areas of the brain, perhaps the hippocampus is involved, and it's through those that kind of like resonance that's an echo that allows you to kind of like maintain that and carry over from one second to, you know, from one episode to the next, or one over those breaks, basically. And
right.
And you could see in that, and certainly when we talk about, you know, what we say long-term memory, he doesn't have that. Clive doesn't have that.
Yeah. So just to be clear, the damage in Clive's case is to the hippocampus. And the reason that he can't form new memories is that that's the hippocampus's job, is to basically take short-term memories, consolidate them, and turn them into long-term memories.
Yeah, basically. I haven't looked at his anatomy. It's been a while since I looked, but I think he also had more, as a limbic encephalitis case, he would have had more also damage to the cortex surrounding the hippocampus, which may have kind of further compromised his ability to kind of retain ongoing information even more so than HM. But, you know, they're basically both very severe cases of amnesia. And the essence of what you're saying is that, I would agree with, is that they, you know, without a functioning hippocampus, you can't encode ongoing experience. That's basically what anterograde amnesia is.
Yeah. And what makes that clip even more compelling is that it brings up this difference between implicit and explicit memory that you bring up, that
yes,
he is still a fantastic musician.
Yes.
And this is sort of illustrates that concept better than I think you could ever possibly explain it. Talk about how his musical abilities are completely untouched.
So, you know, those abilities don't require conscious ongoing effort to execute whatever the sequences of notes. It's just basically a program that's run without, that's run so-called implicitly without, but it even, you know, this is perhaps more, not as prosaic of an example, but think about the fact he can talk. So he's a gifted, you know, professional musician, and it's dramatic to see, oh my God, he can do this incredibly complex thing. Speaking is just as complex. Having a conversation is no less complex, than what he's doing on the piano, and he can do that too, and that we can all relate to. So if any of us should have the terrible misfortune of, you know, having this kind of damage, we would still be able to talk, right? And that's why aphasia, when that is damaged, is so devastating for people, because, you know, then you've lost that function is you know, very devastating. How is it that we can talk? How is it that we can do things? We can walk, we can move, you know, that's memory, right? Because it's some form of memory. It's implicit memory for whether it's motor function or, you know, sequences or understanding how things work, that I can pour, you know, you use utensils or do sophisticated things with tools. You know, those are all what we would consider under this form of implicit memory, which is stored knowledge, which is very resistant to brain damage, and it's generally not affected by hippocampal damage. That's why patients, even, you know, with severe damage to parts of their brain, provided they don't affect the language systems or the motor systems in these cases, they can still talk, they can still move around, do stuff.
So how do memories, you know, represented as underlying neuronal assemblies, morph and shift over time? You know, if you were to activate those same neurons and recall the memory a year later, would it be a very similar assembly to the neurons that were activated a year prior?
So it's interesting. You asked that question kind of from a neurobiological perspective, and people have. And it's not my focus, but, you know, my colleagues, for example, Sheena Jocelyn and Paul Franklin, it's in Toronto here, do that. They actually activate neurons with optogenetics and do exactly what you described. And sure enough, you can do that. You can find the what they call the engram and activate it. Now that's in mice, and it's a beautiful, pure illustration of exactly what you're talking about. So then the question is, well, what happens in humans? We're interested in complex behaviors. I mean, they do it with fear conditioning, where it's like, you know, you're in this cage, and then you got shocked, and then, you know, or whatever, there's a certain sound plays, and then the animal, you know, responds, and they can reactivate that in the absence of a cue. That's sort of the paradigm that they use. How much does that generalize out to, you know, complex behaviors? And when we get into the human level, or even primates or whatever, higher level behaviors, then we're talking about a combination of multiple interacting complex systems that are involved in that transition from, you know, I think your question was around consolidating and solidifying a memory and then reactivating it.
Right.
And so, yes, it can happen at the cellular level, but then systems level, you're dealing with a whole series of things involving stored knowledge, interaction with stored knowledge, sleep, which is something I've studied a lot in my lab, plays a big role. And then there's, you know, what I call the king or queen or whatever your thing is of memory distortion is forgetting. Forgetting accounts for, you know, the vast majority of, like, and the flip side of memory, so-called impairment or distortion. I mean, most of our experiences are actually forgotten. We don't remember the details of most experiences after a certain amount of time has passed. And that's just a very well-documented part of memory. So another way to answer your question is, what makes things resistant to forgetting? That may be another way of phrasing
right.
it.
When we do lose a memory, do we know if that's and this question also sort of generalizes to a lot of memory deficit disorders as well. Is it a storage problem or a retrieval problem?
Yeah, so certainly you can, it's possible to illustrate that it's a retrieval problem because, so again, going back to the neurobiological, like, work at the level of neuronal ensembles, you can rescue a so-called forgotten memory by if you know how to stimulate those ensembles.
Right.
So that suggests that it's retrieval, but for sure you can disrupt storage. I mean, it's easy to disrupt, the disruption of stored memories. So the way you test this is you cue someone. So for example, if someone asks me a story about something that happened 10 years ago, and I'm like, I have no idea. And then they start giving me cues. Eventually, you know, if the memory's still there, I'm going to retrieve it with the help, right? With help of cues. Like, oh, that
right.
occurred in this place. These people were there. This is what you said. This is what you did. Oh my God. Okay. Now I remember. So that's a retrieval issue. And with support, you can retrieve, you know, you can be successful at retrieving. Of course, if you're really good, you can do the support on your own and kind of cue yourself and get down to that, you know, back to that memory on your own. But if sometimes the memories aren't there, and certainly you can do this experimentally or through disease where the cortex is damaged, basically. So there, for example, semantic dementia is a neurodegenerative condition where stored knowledge is affected. And these people actually lose concepts. They lose words. I remember a case I had that was had a beautiful illustration of this. I handed her, I was at doing a naming task and just testing her semantic or conceptual knowledge. I handed her a pencil, and she picked up the pencil, and I was like, what is that? And she looked at it. So this pencil says Statler on it. I remember what kind of pencil it was, but anyway, she read the name of the pencil. She said, well, is it a Statler?
Right.
So she lost the concept of pencil, but she had retained the orthographic ability to decode letters. And so that's all she had to go on, right? So
yeah.
It's like, well, that it's labeled, so it must be whatever that thing says. I have no idea what this is. I mean, the pencil's like, you have to have pretty severe cortical damage to not, in the semantic areas, to not recognize a pencil.
Right.
And she had that, but her ability to decode words was that. So that's a storage issue. She just lost the information, lost the storage. And so it can be both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense. And when she said, is that a Statler, is that a confabulation?
Well, no, because she's reading the word off. I mean, so this is probably a bad example because not everyone knows what Statler is. I don't know what the common pencils are, you know, of your listeners. Anyway,
I think I can visualize the brand.
Yeah, it's like
you get your point.
STAD. Anyway, It's not a confabulation because it's perfectly based in the ground truth of whatever words say. She's not making stuff up. Now in confabulation, people do draw upon whatever, you know, so confabulation is still called honest lying. That's where people have amnesia and then they try to fill in the blanks. And sometimes it can get quite elaborate because they're not kind of checking or monitoring. Wait, is what I'm saying even make sense? So then you can get some, we've seen this too, get into some bizarre, you know, associative confabulations that are based on whatever cues happen to be kind of bubbling up to consciousness. But in this case, she was giving trying her level best to, you know, answer my question with whatever information she could find.
Oh, okay. I see the difference. I remember doing a paper on confabulation in my neuropsych class, and I just thought it was insane. Like, it was so fascinating. Where, you know, you'd have these incidences of patients waking up in a hospital bed and then not understanding how they had gotten there and then thinking they were doctors, because that was the most, that was a rational explanation that came to them, that they must be the doctor because they were in there.
Yeah.
Explain, when do confabulations occur?
Yeah.
What types of amnesia do they incur, and kind of talk more on that?
Yeah. So to have confabulation, you need to have a memory deficit. So you actually have to know, you have to not know what's going on, like in the instance of, so there has to be, and they often arise in the context of confusion, where there may have been a classic example would be like a Korsakoff's syndrome, where someone has had an alcoholic, long-term damage from alcohol use, where due to thiamine deficiency, it damages the basal forebrain area and causes amnesia. It's one of the sites of amnesia. And they get confused. So they wake up confused and amnesic, and they're trying to make sense. I mean, the mind is a sense-making machine. You know, our survival depends on making sense of things. And so in that instance where you remove the memory input, you remove sort of the orientation, and then there's often frontal lobe damage, which is involved in the monitoring. So, you know, if someone with an intact frontal lobe, you wake up in the hospital and they'd be like, oh, I must be working here. Well, with an intact frontal lobe, you'd be like, wait a second, that makes no sense. Like, it's not possible. Let's try another, you know, let's reject that and try another solution. But instead they sort of accept the first thing that comes to mind because they're not basically monitoring. And there's you could think of that as a desperate attempt to basically make sense of your world without any checks, you know, and balances, without any kind of triangulation with reality.
Right. Why do you think, or maybe he did at times, but at least in those videos with Clive, he wasn't confabulating. No. He was just saying, I've never seen anybody. Yeah. I'm not conscious. Yeah. I'm dead. I'm not dreaming. He was being very... I don't even know what the word is.
Like, I mean, again,
very practical, very pragmatic,
and also kind of accurate in the way. If I had to describe, I have no idea what that feels like, but he describes it in terms that just are what I would consider accurate, or at least makes sense with respect to his experience. So when someone's confabulating, they're having input coming in. So he may have an attack. Intact frontal lobe function that allows him, basically he wakes up and he's like, and he does say things like, the people around here don't know what they're doing. So you can consider that a sense of like, something's wrong. It must be the people here don't know what they're doing, you know,
because
something is wrong, you know, and I don't have an answer. So now if you wanted, you could call it confabulation, because what is the evidence? I mean, aside from the fact that he's not getting better, is it really the fact, you know, it's not the case that people don't know what they're doing. So he's trying to make sense of his world. But no, he doesn't have the florid kind of dramatic confabulations like the ones you're talking about, perhaps because he's got some intact ability to kind of... The idea that something's... I'm stuck here in this situation because there are a bunch of incompetent people who don't know what they're doing is more... Maybe his brain could accommodate that versus like, well, I must be working here, you know?
Right.
Because he had the reasoning ability to basically reject that hypothesis as, you know, something that's worth considering. It just would never come to mind.
Do you know how often or like how regular confabulations are in cases of antrograde amnesia?
It's not rare. And given the right configuration of damage, you know, it's not surprising. But it tends to resolve. So most you know, generally with confabulation, people do, you know, get better over time. Not always, but when it does happen, usually, you know, hopefully there's enough residual brain function that over time people sort of like compensate and learn, you know, to get constrained on those sorts of associations.
And what is the treatment involved in trying to correct someone's confabulations and bring them back into reality?
You know, I don't know that there's any empirically like tested formal treatments, but I think most clinicians would say, don't fight with the person. You know, there are ways to make it worse for sure. So if you argue with them, that's going to make it worse. So don't argue with them, but also orient them, get them grounded in time and space. Keep, you know, show them pictures, talk about what happened, you know, because hopefully they can learn, right? They can learn and get better. And then with time, hopefully they will. And, you know, when patients, you know, I've talked to patients who've recovered from another comparable syndrome is a psychosis, where people aren't responding to reality, basically. They're delusional and you talk to them later and they're like, I mean, that's quite common, you know, unfortunately, psychosis or delusional syndromes. And when people recover, they're like, yeah, I had no idea what was going on there. That didn't make any sense, you know, and it resolves and they recover. So then they can reflect on the fact that was not appropriate, whatever they were doing.
Is there actually any difference between a momentary confabulation and an episode of psychosis?
Yes. No, they're different. Okay. They're different. I mean, but behaviorally, they can be similar in the sense that people are not, you know, in the broad sense that people are not responding. And certainly there are common elements, I would say, in the terms of frontal systems or executive function, where people are somehow, for whatever reason, they've lacked kind of that control and monitoring over their memory. So in both cases, I would say they have that in common, but the underlying origin of those are completely different.
Right.
Yeah.
Speak to me more about your clinical experience, because again, sitting across the table from some of these people that might have these memory deficits, where they have such a disconnect between their memory and their experience, like what their sensory system is telling them and their own memories. What does that create in people? You know, like that disconnect. I mean, surely a lot of angst, a lot of, you know, it's very scary, a lot of confusion. Like, what does it kind of create in people?
So I just want to make sure I understand the question. So this is an instance where, say, in a patient that they've had a brain lesion and they don't understand what's happening. And then, like, is that the question?
Yeah, I guess any sort of memory deficit where you just have a person who has a very different experience than their own memories. You know, right. Either you have Jimmy G, who is the Korsakoff syndrome in Oliver Sacks' book, where he's living in, I think, 1946 or something, right, just after World War II.
So they can't. I get it. They can't reconcile basically the here and now with whatever's in their memory. So
exactly.
Yeah. So, you know, of course, we can't know what that experience is. It's going to be highly individual in the sense of absolutely anxiety would be part of it. You could imagine someone getting agitated. I mean, agitation and behavioral problems are probably among the worst thing for a family, you know, to cope with when someone is not connected to reality and they're agitated, you know, and it's actually an understandable response, and they might be lashing out or angry or physically violent. You know, you can see that, or you can see these cases where they're kind of calm and they're like, no, I actually do work here. In that sense, I mean, it's more of a psychodynamic thing of like people are, again, trying to make sense of their world, and they're trying to put their thing is to be competent and to put themselves like, I'm in this situation. I'm a competent person. I'm a capable person. And, you know, this is how I'm reconciling all of that. So I would say that experience is highly individualized, you know?
Yeah. Are there any just proven higher rates of any types of mental illness?
higher rates just of occurrence or?
Yeah, with people that have a memory deficit disorder, is there higher occurrence of mental illness?
Oh, I see. Not necessarily. There are certain mental conditions that can strongly interact with memory. So PTSD is a disorder of memory, post-traumatic stress
trauma,
disorder, because you have an excessive activation of, you know, and you're as if you're reliving something even when that thing isn't happening right then. Psychosis causes, you know, psychotic conditions cause memory impairment just through it, damage to integrated brain functioning. But if you go the other way around, from memory disorders back to mental health conditions, I mean, you know, in some sense, everything is correlated, because people who get diseases, sometimes they get for various reasons, get susceptible to other diseases. But I don't know if, you know, when we think about memory disorders, we think about, you know, neurodegenerative disease, Alzheimer's being the most common, epilepsy, also a big one, traumatic brain injury. I mean, these things generally are not necessarily, having a previous mental disorder isn't necessarily a risk factor for those memory conditions.
Right.
Yeah.
I was just curious if anything had popped up, because I had an incredible discussion with Sadie, who introduced us in the first place.
Yeah.
Sadie is amazing.
Yeah,
she's like the happiest, most energetic, and most enthusiastic person I've ever talked to in my life.
Yeah.
Absolutely loved our podcast together.
Yeah.
And she said that, like, and again, she's speaking from her own experience, which is very hard to reconcile with ours. Mm-hmm. But she can't sweat about the future. You know, that was what she was saying. Like, she can't time travel back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
And she says that sometimes gives her a little bit of stress, because she can't plan, but she's also not too fussed about it. You know, she doesn't suffer any huge stress or anxiety thinking about either the future or the past, which is a big source of angst and stress
absolutely.
For pretty much everyone with proper, you know, with normal faculty.
Yeah. So absolutely. Like I actually think she can plan for the future, in the sense of, like, she's a very high functioning person.
Right.
And she can engage those semantic kind of, like, knowledge abilities, which is something I've talked a lot about with her. We haven't touched upon is sort of, like, you could say, like, what is that memory good for? So the most, you know, our day-to-day function, generally we're not, don't require us to have rich experiences of ourselves in the past, right? I mean, for you to do your job, or, you know, for us to do, we're not. Most of that doesn't involve, like, thinking about the past directly.
True.
It involves expertise and knowledge, even if it's just day to day activities, expertise like driving or what, you know, preparing food or whatever. In her case, and then the dark side of memory is more around, you know, this incredible ability that we have to be conscious of ourselves, to think about ourselves, to think about the future in great detail, to think about the past. The dark side of that is that you can be anxious about the past and future. You can ruminate on something that happened in the past, even if it's no longer relevant, still dominating your consciousness, you know, something embarrassing you said or whatever. And then you can think about the future in ways that are highly dysfunctional. There's a real, you know, I got started studying autobiographical memory and episodic memory because I was so interested in those deficits, that, you know, and the great advantages of memory and the great loss that occurs when you have a memory impairment. Now I'm actually kind of turning to the other side of things, which is, you know, how can people with memory impairments, so Sadie, among other things, has this thing we discovered called severely deficient autobiographical memory. But she's high functioning. How is, and of course, she's not the only one. We have many people we study like this. How is that true? And in fact, perhaps even higher functioning in some ways.
Right.
We think that having a rich memory can actually interfere with solving some problems or functioning in the world. Because if you get stuck on a specific example that of whatever problem you're trying to solve, it's like a mechanical problem or a social problem or whatever, being effective involves actually abstracting what works across episodes. Yes, you can draw upon specific episodes and say, oh, last time I tried that, it didn't work so well. Maybe I'll try this. But really, most of it is about, most of expertise isn't about episodes.
It's right.
About learning and extracting generalities.
The first thing I thought when I was reading her book, which is amazing, about her experiences as a prosopagnosiac, which is face blindness. I thought she was excellent with words. She's brilliant. She's so wishy the way she was using her words. And I was like, I wonder, is the way that she connects words somehow enhanced because she's also an aphantasiac? Is that the way you say that? She has aphantasia. So she can't visualize images.
Yeah.
So all she has is words. Yeah. That's words are her mode of being. That's her mental models. That's her existence. And has that in some way heightened her linguistic abilities?
Yeah.
She's a journalist, a scientific journalist. But like, I just remember her connecting words in ways that I would never even think to do.
Absolutely. Words, and I might go further than that, to ideas, because the essence of, you know, in some case, I mean, yes, so we're talking about Sadie, she's very articulate, she's a wonderful writer, like her book, Do I Know You, is fantastic.
It's amazing, it really is.
And, and so for sure she has extraordinary verbal abilities, but also she has strong conceptual abilities. And in fact, when we look in similar cases, people developmentally, so these, to be clear, all these conditions you're talking about in her case and that we're studying now in my lab are developmental conditions, the way you're born. They're not clinical disorders because these people are not presenting, you know, at a clinic saying like, I can't function. They're all highly functioning. And so the thing we're interested in, severely deficient autobiographical memory or aphantasia, very similar, is we're actually finding these people have enhanced conceptual abilities. And so we're seeing a lot higher incidence of scientists. You know, there's a great article by one of our index SDAM cases named Nick Watkins. He wrote a great article in Neuropsychologia about, he's a theoretical physicist. So there's someone who traffics in abstract ideas, and he thinks, and I agree with him, that his capacities actually are related to his lack of imagery and his lack of memory, because he's really, really good at seeing, if you will, connections conceptually, and not getting distracted by irrelevant visual information.
That's so interesting, because you can, on first analysis, you could think that, of course, you know, not visualizing is going to be a drawback. Mm-hmm. But that is a first analysis. So on if you really go deeper, you really can see how, you know, these things, maybe we shouldn't call them syndromes or defects. They really are just alternative mental states. You know, that's one thing that Sadie really drilled into me, is that just the conscious experience is so much more variable. And she clearly has an enormous amount of benefits.
Yeah.
Another one that I was thinking about was the flow state. You know, a lot of people go through a lot of effort, me included, to be able to erase the future and the past and be in the moment while working. But if I have a deep work session where I'm really trying to get in the moment, and then I'm thinking, God, I can't believe 1 year ago I went in to shake that person's hand and they went in to hug and that was so odd. And then I'd be thinking about that for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And I'd be like, you know, just the most random thing would come to my head. Or when you're trying to sleep and I'm just thinking about some stupid, you know, memory when I was 11 that I accidentally called my history teacher my auntie, you know, just the most random stuff, and it impacts you in the moment.
Yeah.
But if she only lives in the now, I'm really curious to know what her work sessions are like.
Yeah.
You know, 'cause you only want to be in the now when you're working, really. Yeah. I mean, you're trying to connect ideas that are in front of you.
Yeah. I think that's a good, interesting, you know, observation, is that, when we're in that state, we can all access that state. And I think, you know, mindfulness is actually for many people is an effective way to not necessarily to get into that state, but to resist the distraction. So when that thought comes to you, whether it's a memory or a thought, that you can let go of it, and you can actually let go of it without interrupting what you're doing. Because there's a great state quote, I don't know who said it, in Buddhism or mindfulness, they say, if you have a mind, it will wander. So if you have a mind, like, don't, you know, Stop beating yourself up. It's supposed to wander. That's what minds do. And so then the question is, instead of saying, man, you know, what's wrong with me? I'm good. You got, then the skill becomes letting go of that so that you can just basically not get stuck, you know?
Right. I never asked her. Meditation is such an interesting one. I wonder if she could just sit there and meditate for hours and it not be an issue. Because we just start, you know, ruminating on problems. You start thinking about all the embarrassing moments when you were five and you know, all of the ridiculous things come to head. But a really interesting way, when she isn't receiving any stimulus.
Yeah.
And she has her eyes closed and she's not thinking about the past and the future. Yeah. What is her brain doing?
Yeah. You have to, I mean, I can't, I have no idea.
I know.
So I can say in general, I mean, I think it happens to everybody. Developing, for most of us, to develop that skill of letting go of your thoughts takes practice. And the more you practice, the better you are at it. And you know, I don't know what it would be like for her in particular.
Talk about aphantasia. I'm just going to
pause for a second.
Please.
So I'm supposed to meet with someone at 1:30. I can push it, but I'm just curious if you wanted to maybe, you know, schedule another one.
1:30 your time, is that now?
That's now, yeah.
No, don't worry about pushing it. This has been an absolute thrill. I don't want to hold you for any more time. I've learned so much, and I've really, really enjoyed this. I really appreciate you, and thank you so much for coming on.
Yeah, well, it's my pleasure. When do you expect this will be out, dropped, or whatever you say, whatever you call it?
It would probably take a week or two to properly edit it. I like to do nice trailers to get people engaged and have the interesting bits at the start. So people with their shrunken attention, TikTok attention spans will stick through a full hour and a half conversation about neuroscience.
Yeah.
But in a couple of weeks and I'll ping you when it's out.
Great. Well, that's great. Great questions and really enjoy talking to you. So thank you
so much, Brian. All the best. Great weekend.
Okay.
Thank you so much.